Hey everybody, and welcome to EM Ultra Uprising, and welcome to the WWE Raw Review for February 22nd, 2016. This marks the 8-year anniversary of the day that I created this very channel on YouTube all the way back in 2008. It's pretty crazy to think I've been using this channel for that much time, although I've only been uploading wrestling videos on a regular basis for about 4 years or so. But it's always good to commemorate the amount of time that you have spent here on YouTube. So thanks for joining me here today on this wonderful occasion, and a wonderful occasion it was indeed, getting a blockbuster return, a Hall of Fame announcement, some WrestleMania buildup, and more to come from this episode of Raw. Before we start, though, if you didn't get a chance to check out my Fastlane review, the link is in the description, so go ahead and check it out. Let's get into Raw. Starting the night, now I would have opened this review with me doing my own impression of the Shane O'Mac dance with the music playing in the background, but because of the fact that I know copyright issues would probably play a role, I unfortunately am not going to do that. I would probably also be mimicking The Godfather at some point within this review as well. But again, due to copyright restrictions, I feel like that's not a good idea and not very feasible. But here comes the money! Shane McMahon is back in WWE for the first time since, I believe, 2009 was the last time we have seen him at all. Pretty fucking amazing is not even close to an understatement. Like, it was unbelievable and shocking because it was always seemed to have been said these last number of years, in particular the last 3 or 4, that Shane would never be back. Like, we would never see him again. And yet, here we are, Shane's back, and it was an amazing moment and an amazing return during the opening segment, where it was the presentation of the Vincent J. McMahon Award presented by Vincent K. McMahon to Stephanie McMahon. And Shane just called out that bullshit and called out the bullshit of the company lately, the way it's been moving, and that he wants this business to still be alive going forward. And in the direction it's going, it ain't going to stay there. He did break some kayfabe here, did say some things that were, you know, beyond the regular dimensions of a professional wrestling storyline. And it was awesome. It was gritty. It was interesting. The return was amazing, and you were glued to your television set. This is one situation where you had a half-hour-long promo to kick off Raw, and you loved every minute of it. Awesome way to kick off the night. And on top of that, the match announcement. So Shane wants the control of Monday Night Raw. The reason he wants control of Monday Night Raw is because he wants to bring back greatness into the WWE. Well, Vince says, the only way you're getting power is if you have one match whenever I say, against whomever I say. Shane agrees to the deal, and Vince puts him in a Hell in a Cell match against The Undertaker at WrestleMania. Talk about blockbuster match, implications on the line, Hell in a Cell, seeing Shane wrestle for the first time in years, against a guy he's wrestled against before in The Undertaker. The Undertaker, the best WrestleMania performer of all time. Oh my God. Not only is this the best opponent for Undertaker in a few years, but it's also way more exciting than all the rumors that we had heard for Undertaker's opponent. And more importantly than all of that, this is how you get the road to WrestleMania really kicked off. You know, we called last night's pay-per-view Fastlane, even though it was nothing but a sputtering fucking mess. This was exactly how you start off the Raw after that garbage and get us on the right track heading into WrestleMania. What an awesome match. I'm already way more excited for WrestleMania just from this one segment than I am from everything that happened prior to. Really great opener. Holy shit. What a return. Holy shit. Anyway, let's move right on to our first match, The New Day defeating the Lucha Dragons and Neville. And this match carried on for some time, so we were already at hour two by the end of this match. I mean, this was an enjoyable six-man tag, The New Day getting the win, as they should, and some good spots throughout. But it was harder to stay as invested and pay as much attention to this match because you were so excited still from what had just happened in the opener. Although it was a good and enjoyable wrestling match. So anyway, these first couple segments, obviously the opener gets two huge thumbs up from me, and this first match gets a thumbs up as well. An enjoyable way to kick off the night as far as in-ring action goes. Even if the match didn't have so much of a point, it was still enjoyable in-ring work, and it wasn't anything that was too much down your throat right after you had just gotten such a huge opening segment. So it was a good kind of way to counterbalance that, not with some trash, but with a match that was actually somewhat decent. We move on to a Roman Reigns interview where he says, "This is my time, my goal, I finally reached it. It's going to be just me and Triple H in front of the whole world. I like my odds at WrestleMania." A pretty solid interview from Reigns, although I didn't really like that they showed him on his cell phone before. Like, that shows me that he's not as invested. You know, I want to see him looking gritty and you know, ready to go. I don't think we need to see him on his phone. I think that was kind of pointless. Anyway, let's move on to something else. That interview was a thumbs up as well. The Godfather is in the Hall of Fame, and let's all get on the whole train, baby, because that man deserves this moment. Hard worker, got a gimmick over that was very intriguing, very different, definitely rode the edge of what was okay and not okay to put into professional wrestling, even in the Attitude Era. It was at the right time, the right place, and the right guy was playing the right role, and it was fun, entertaining, enjoyable. That is the type of gimmick, and what that man did for this business is something that so many mid-card talents and mid-card writers and bookers can learn from. Because that's a great example of a character who was fun, was different, rode the edge, was out there, and was fun as a mid-card talent, and made it so that the mid-card championship, like the IC title, actually felt like it was something worth, it had some worth to it. And he was fun and enjoyable. And there's not a whole lot of characters out there like that right now. So definitely deserving of the Hall of Fame and a great selection choice by WWE. So let's move on to Brock Lesnar and Paul Heyman coming out, with Heyman giving the usual spiel on Lesnar and how he's the biggest draw in WWE, and that Brock is extremely pissed off because he's not going to main event WrestleMania this year, and that Dean Ambrose is to blame for that. And we get the flashback that we had already seen a couple of times by this point in the show of prior to Raw, Dean Ambrose getting the shit kicked out of him and having to be, you know, taken away in an ambulance at the hands of Brock Lesnar, which was awesome. It was awesome to see Lesnar toss him onto the windshield of a car and get him tossed out in an ambulance. Then, during this segment, we hear the ambulance come back. Dean Ambrose comes back in, driving the ambulance into the arena, has a very crazed look, stumbles and crawls his way all the way up to Lesnar, and then Lesnar steps on his head, and then Ambrose grabs the mic that Heyman had and says that he wants a street fight, no holds barred, at WrestleMania against Brock, and Brock accepts, then F5's Ambrose, he can't F5 himself, F5's Ambrose, and just completely looks dominant. But I really am looking forward to this. It's different from what we were expecting with the Bray Wyatt situation. The way that Bray Wyatt and the Wyatt family are right now, Ambrose and Lesnar makes more sense, it's more dynamic, it's different, and I think the match can be really enjoyable. I really do think these two could put on a good one. Do I see Dean Ambrose as a really, like, legit and on-par type of opponent for Brock Lesnar? I wouldn't say so. However, I'm still going to back away from that piece of the puzzle and say that I am looking forward to this on the perspective and on the spectrum of it being a match, and it's going to be enjoyable, and it was good, solid way to establish and build up to a match for WrestleMania. So thus far in the night, we've got double thumbs ups, we've got nothing but praise for this show. Now we get to a tag match. The Usos defeat the Ascension. But prior to the match, the Dudley boys came out. They said that the Usos need to learn respect, and they are here to show them that and also show that their legacy, meaning the Dudleys, is a lot bigger than just some one-dimensional weapon, meaning the table. So it looks like the Dudleys and Usos are going to feud, and I'm okay with a tag feud that has nothing to do with the tag titles. That's not a big deal to me. I don't even care if they do put them in the tag title scenario as well. The Ascension were kind of just there to be there, but the promo from the Dudleys was fine, and I do look forward to seeing where they go with this, but, you know, really, it kind of balanced out. The match didn't care for, the promo was cool, so a thumbs middle for me. Now we get Chris Jericho and AJ Styles showing respect to one another in the ring. Okay, fine. They had a good match at Fastlane. They had their trio of matches, and Jericho says that Styles proved that he is truly phenomenal. They shake hands. And then the social outcasts come out. So you already know this segment is going in a weird direction. Social outcasts come out, make fun of both AJ Styles and Chris Jericho. And then it ultimately leads to a tag team match where Jericho and Styles obviously go over in a complete waste of time match. And you had JBL calling them Y2AJ. I was like, please never say that. Yeah, this was pretty much the filler waste of time. Like, oh man, please use AJ Styles more effectively than this. Please, dear God. So, thumbs down for me. We move on to Triple H and Stephanie seeing backstage where he's trying to calm her down, saying that the show may have started off poorly, but this night will end in our favor. Good stuff. Good stuff. Thumbs up there. Then we get another segment after our commercial break where Stephanie McMahon is telling Roman Reigns that he is wrestling Sheamus tonight in the main event. And I'm like, oh my God, please, please no, please no, please no. We don't need this. So, thumbs down. Goldust and R-Truth have a backstage segment. And unfortunately, these backstage segments between R-Truth and Goldust have really started to lose their luster very quickly. They were really funny the first two or three times. They're really not that funny right now. And this particular one, to me, wasn't funny at all. It was basically the old Goldust has a cake that says he's sorry, R-Truth shoves it into his face. Does that really do much of anything? I mean, it didn't really make me laugh at all, so. I mean, I do want to see the Golden Truth as a tag team. I still do, and I still think it'd be fun. But, like, some of these segments haven't really been as funny as one would have hoped, because the chemistry between the two is natural, but I didn't think this one was all that well executed. Anyway, moving on, so thumbs down. Oh, God. I don't even want to read this. The Wyatt family defeat Kane, Big Show, and Ryback in a six-man tag rematch at Fastlane. What I don't understand about this is you had the worst match at Fastlane the night before in this six-man tag. I mean, there was like three that could have gone down for worst match, and this was right up there in that category. You had that bad of a match at Fastlane with these six guys, and you say, you know what we should do? Let's have it again. Let's just do it again, right? Like, you know what? Good idea, guys. Let's take that terrible match and let's just fucking shove it down your throats again. No big deal. Yeah, big deal. It fucking sucks. The Wyatts win, and I don't give a fuck. They lost at the pay-per-view, and that was the more important match, in my opinion. I don't care that Bray wasn't in the pay-per-view match and was on this match on Raw. The only reason they won was because Ryback left and said he has nothing else to prove. He already won the match on Sunday and injured Luke Harper. Not obviously very badly because Harper was in this match. Holy crap, do I not give a fuck about any of this. The only thing I liked about any of it was Ryback saying that he wants to focus on himself from here on out. Was that a pretty cool backstage interview to get after the match because he had left it? Yes, but I don't want him to turn full out heel. Because the last time Ryback was heel, it wasn't successful. It didn't work. It wasn't effective. It wasn't good. The guy's over. He needs to be more of a babyface. So I don't like the heel direction it's going in, but did I like what Ryback had to say? Absolutely. So I'm very mixed on how I feel about that. This six-man tag as a whole is a complete 5 million thumbs down. Because if it sucked at Fastlane, what made anyone think the match was going to be any better the next night on Raw baffles me to no end. Let's just move on. Ryback's, what he had to say was a thumbs up for me. But I don't want him to be a heel. I'm really not a fan of that idea. Let's move on. Sasha Banks defeats Naomi in a match. Becky Lynch had evened the odds by taking down Tamina at ringside, which helped lead to Sasha's victory. And then Becky and Sasha show a little respect before Charlotte comes on out and says, the you two will face each other, meaning Sasha and Becky. Winner will face me at WrestleMania. Now, I really was hoping they were going to build up to a triple threat match between Becky, Sasha, and Charlotte for the title at WrestleMania. In all honesty, I thought that would have been the best angle to go with, and I think they honestly could have torn the house down. I'm not saying that Charlotte versus Sasha or Charlotte versus Becky. I'm assuming it's going to be Charlotte. It's a lot of Charlotte versus Sasha will be the match that we'll get at WrestleMania, I would assume. But either way, I was kind of hoping for a triple threat. But I will say, overall, this did what it needed to do. Again, Naomi and Tamina being the placeholders, Sasha and Becky continuing to work together, Charlotte being the champion coming out, you know, planting the seeds for that match between those two, setting up a WrestleMania match in the process. Charlotte was quite robotic in this segment. I was more entertained by Ric Flair just jumping and hopping around after he'd had about 55 cups of coffee. Woo! And yeah, that was pretty much the most exciting part about Charlotte speaking. But I will say, at least there was the seeds were planted for WrestleMania for the Divas Championship. So that's a nice thing to have. So then we get a little backstage segment before our main event. Vince reassuring Stephanie McMahon and saying that this may be a calculated risk, meaning Shane versus Undertaker, but it's one that works in our favor, where Shane will likely still not get control of WWE Raw. And Vince also admitted earlier in the night, clearly, that if Raw went down, that the whole company would go down. So, just sitting there like, yep, you're just literally admitting that SmackDown doesn't matter anymore. Like, that really gives the viewers a huge incentive to buy SmackDown tickets and go and see your shows and watch it on TV every week. Definitely, man. Without Raw, our company's gone. Wait, but what about SmackDown? Oh, yeah. Doesn't matter, right? Anyway, let's move on to the main event. Roman Reigns and Sheamus. Now, this is not a match that I would look forward to ever, really. Sheamus' character just is so shitty. Like, there's just... it's just such a bad character. And it's sad to say that because I honestly like Sheamus as a performer. And there's been times where he has done really well, has put on some very good matches, and has honestly been a solid character. I always liked him better as a heel. But this particular gimmick started off real hot, red as his fucking head. And then it went down in a fucking heap really quickly. And by the time he was Money in the Bank holder, I was already starting to lose interest. And that was only about 2 months in. Then you move on for, you know, the next couple of months, and I just like him less and less. And then we get to the League of Nations, him winning the belt, all that other stuff. And it just got even less entertaining. And then him being in this main event here, just a big shrug of the shoulders, you know, to be completely honest, that made me shrug my shoulders so hard I knocked something over. Anyway, not really much of a match to be remembered. What I loved, and I mean loved, about this segment was the fact that there was a humongous brawl between Triple H and Roman Reigns to finish the night. And that is exactly what WWE needed to do to finish this Raw in an effective manner. And they did that. So the main event match might have not been anything, but it ended up in a no contest anyway. And the brawl that came after it was well worth the wait because of how great it was. Awesome because Triple H A comes out in street clothes, which made him look fucking badass with the championship. And then for Reigns to just slide out of the ring and just boom. Instantly started. Reigns didn't, you know, tell him to come here. Reigns wanted it just as bad as Triple H. They start punching each other back and forth. And then the Superman punch from Reigns. Triple H ends up turning it around by hitting Reigns with the ring bell, which is something we haven't seen in a while, which was awesome. And then Triple H just smashing Reigns' face off of the announce table about 15 or 20 times. Just absolutely savagery. That doesn't even make sense. That's how, like, crazy it just was. He just went off on the guy. And then after that, Reigns is all bloodied and all battered. I don't know if he got nicked on the ring bell or if it was just from him getting his face knocked off the announce table that many times. But it looked like he might have broken his nose or something along those lines. Anyway, all the refs try to separate Triple H. He ends up breaking through and breaking off the steel steps and pedigreeing Roman Reigns head first onto the bottom part of the steel stairs, and just a complete destruction of Roman Reigns on the part of Triple H. This is how you start to build up the biggest pay-per-view of the year. That's awesome, WWE. Hats off to you. Hats off to you. I know I wear a hat in some of these videos. I don't have one on this time, but my invisible hat is off to you, because that is a main event level feel. A brawl, it's personal, like, fuck it, We've had our, Triple H feels like, hey, me and my wife have been screwed all night. Enough's fucking enough. Let's put him in a match, and then let's fuck him up. And that's exactly what Triple H did. He had a purpose, he had a reason, he had a mission for it, and he did what he set out to do. He was an asshole, he was a heel, he was exactly what he needed to be. Now, I understand the crowd was chanting and enjoying what Triple H was doing, which may not have been the intended response, but it was a very well-executed brawl. It was fun to watch. It felt like it mattered. It felt like it was personal. And that's the exact start down the path to making this feud good. And that's what I said needed to happen before. Reigns winning at Fastlane, yes, very predictable. Okay, we all knew it was going to happen. Despite any of that, you can still take away one important factor, and it is that Roman Reigns versus Triple H can still be an amazing and awesome and sweet and fantastic feud if it's built up properly. This is step one in doing that. Very good start. I hope that they will continue along this momentum. They have to each week, but this is the first and important step in that process. So very good stuff. Huge thumbs up from me. And overall, Raw is worth a good B plus. This was a very, very good Raw. Now, the only reason it misses an A is because there was that funk period. You know, you had a really good, like, first hour, hour and a half, and then things just went downhill for about an hour. And then, you know, the last, like, 20 minutes or so, you know, things picked up again, or at least the last 10 with the Brawl. So, this was a good Raw. This was a very good post-Fastlane Raw. What made me laugh is I remember saying to myself multiple times throughout this show, is this really the same company that just put out a terrible pay-per-view the night before? How do they just put out maybe the worst pay-per-view that I've seen in multiple years the night before they put on a very enjoyable Raw? It's almost as if they sat there and said, Jesus, we really screwed up on this pay-per-view. We need to pull out the stops on Raw. You have Shane return, Shane and Undertaker set up. You have Ambrose versus Lesnar set up, the seeds planted for the Divas Championship match, and on top of that, you have main event buildup between Triple H and Roman Reigns. You already know three matches, you're on the verge of knowing a fourth one as well. That is really fucking good start to building up WrestleMania 32. My faith feels a little bit more restored after Fastlane made me just sit there and kind of like say, oh man, WrestleMania 32 might have some issues this year. And which is sad to say because the last couple of Manias were really, really good. But I have a little more faith in this WrestleMania right now. Again, you still had a repetitive, boring six-man tag, a poor use of Jericho and Styles in this show. Segments that weren't amazing by any stretch. But the return of Shane McMahon, Godfather in the Hall of Fame, and Triple H and Roman Reigns brawling to end the night. Great stuff. And Dean Ambrose really played up the lunatic role very well here on this show. Lesnar and him should be a fun one as well. So, really good WrestleMania build-up, a very good show. There was, like I said, a dull patch in there, so it's not an A show, but it still is deserving of a B-plus for all that it did accomplish. Very good. Nice way to kick off the road to WrestleMania, and that concludes the Raw review for EM Ultra Uprising. Thank you for watching. Be sure to like, comment your own thoughts on Raw. Be sure to check out my Fastlane review. I will be back with you guys on Thursday the 25th, for my next Q&A video. All set on questions. If you have any you want to ask me at the time, I should be able to have a little bit of time afterwards to answer some live questions. Looking forward to it all. Thank you guys for watching, and I will see you for the Q&A. Like I said, like this video. Also, comment your thoughts on the review itself as well as your thoughts on Raw. Subscribe for plenty more to come, and I can't wait to be with you guys for the Q&A. And until then, you guys have yourselves a wonderful couple of days. Peace.